Hello and welcome to The Future Report, a podcast hosted by social research company McCrindle for anyone curious about the future. My name is Ashley Fell, and each week I'll be sitting down with a guest to discuss a topic or trend that you need to know about. When you think about executive boards and governance, I wonder what you think. At their worst, perhaps, boards can be perceived to be a little bit disconnected and can stifle the progress of passionate organisational cultures. Yet, as our world gets increasingly complex, organisations are required to navigate these times of ever-changing social attitudes, demographic shifts, and technological disruptions, just to name some of the megatrends that they're combating and trying to understand. So today we're going to discuss the important role that boards play in guiding the future of organisations and also the transition happening in many boardrooms with the next generation of leaders coming through in senior roles and even changing who or what boards are comprised of. And joining me today to discuss this topic is McCrindle's Director of Strategy, Grant Dusting. So, hey Grant, welcome to the Future Report podcast.
Hey Ash, it's good to be here.
So delighted to have you involved, and you are the absolute perfect person for this discussion today. And Grant, for our listeners who maybe haven't worked with you before or don't know you, it's a question I think I've asked every guest so far on the podcast, but could you tell our listeners what generation you belong to?
Sure. So I'm a Gen Y, 32 years old, and that's my generation, Ash.
Yes, well, it's mine as well. And it's also, we're often also called the Millennials. And there are, as we know, as researchers, and you deliver presentations all the time, Grant, on these topics like I do, there are a lot of stereotypes that exist about every generation, but also about the Millennials or the Gen Ys, you know, us in our late 20s and our 30s and having kids. And as we shared, you know, as I just mentioned, the Millennials and the Gen Ys are moving into more senior leadership roles now as they gain more experience. In our last episode with Shelley, we talked a lot about Millennials and some of the stereotypes, and we've talked about it with Mark too. But Grant, before we dive into the topic today, I thought I'd ask you a very important question. With one of the stereotypes being Millennials loving brunch and smashed avo and coffee, what's your take on all that? What's your take on what you order when you go out to brunch?
Well, I am guilty of enjoying a good brunch, probably too often. I'm not a coffee drinker though. So I think that, particularly in our Aussie context, I think that sometimes puts me on the outer a bit. So yeah, brunch, yeah. Yes, coffee, no.
Okay, so that is interesting. I feel like you might be in the minority there, the Millennials who aren't into coffee, but you know, you do you, Grant. What is your coffee order though? I mean, you're always out to clients for client meetings. What do you order? Just have some water? Surely you order something hot
well,
beverage, right?
You do need to be a bit pragmatic because it doesn't have the same ring to it to say, would you like to catch up over an English breakfast tea? Right? It's just easy to say over a coffee.
Yeah.
So, yeah, I'll have a mocha. I'm a chocolate guy. So hot chocolate, mocha, or maybe something more healthy like a smoothie.
Yeah,
nice. That'd be me.
Yeah. You're so right, though, in terms of when you meet someone, you're like, it is just want to go for a coffee. And then I guess, yeah, I do wonder what are the coffee drinkers order when they're going out for coffee. So that makes sense. Okay, Grant. So we're talking about boards today, and I'd love for you to share a little bit about your personal connection with boards with our listeners, if you can.
Yeah, sure. Well, I interact with a lot of board members through my role at McCrindle because they tend to be the ones who are looking ahead to the future. They want to understand the big picture. They're thinking that bird's eye view. So by virtue of the role I do here at McCrindle, often we're interacting with boards directly to either commission research or engage us in an advisory capacity. Or it might be that someone in the organization, maybe in the executive team, is engaging us for research, which is going to be presented to the board. So often I'm interacting with boards either in a presentation, being the end user, or actually with them directly as a client. But in addition to that, I also am on the board of a not-for-profit, a charity that's Australian-based. And so I suppose that gives me a bit of an insider's perspective in addition to my McCrindle hat.
Yeah, absolutely. And yeah, that's incredible that you're on the board of an organization at a relatively young age. A personal question, Grant. I mean, was it an interesting decision when you were asked to join that? I just asked that because, yeah, I've been approached recently to join a board. And, yeah, as a young, you know, millennial, it's been a little bit daunting to kind of, like you said, boards are tasked with a big role, an important role in guiding organisations. How was that for you when they approached you originally for that?
Well, I think any organisation would be really pleased to have you on their board, Ash. So I think whoever that is, they're doing a great job.
Thank you.
Yeah, to be completely honest, I received an email out of the blue one day from someone I didn't know that, to be honest, looked a bit like a spam email. I wasn't sure if it was legit. It just said, do you want to be on this board? If so, let's have a chat. And I thought, wow. So it turns out it was from a recruiter, so who recruits particularly for executives and board roles. And so, yeah, I followed my curiosity. That was when I was 26. So
wow.
The funny thing is I had written down about 12 months before then that I was just reflecting on life and what I enjoyed. And I said to myself, well, I actually really enjoy being involved in strategic planning and thinking about the future. And whenever I've got to do that, I've really enjoyed that opportunity. So I thought, I think that's what boards do. And so maybe one day I'd really like to be on a board, thinking 26-year-old me, that would probably be in 26 more years, when I'm in my 50s.
Yeah,
that's
right.
In my mind what board members looked like. So, yeah, the opportunity came a lot sooner than I was expecting, but the organisation and the opportunity just really jumped out at me, and I was very delighted to get that opportunity.
Yeah, absolutely. And I know that you treat that role with a lot of respect and reverence, and yeah, like likewise, you know, that organization is incredibly lucky to have you and your wisdom on that. And even as your role at McCrindle, Grant, you know, you're the director of strategy. So that makes sense that you like strategic thinking and strategic planning and looking to the future. If you had to explain to someone, like, you know, thinking back to that 26-year-old Grant who, you know, was asked to be on that board, even for myself, you know, younger millennials or even Gen Zs who are wondering what boards do, maybe, what would you say to someone who was asking you, what's the role of a board? What do they do?
Well, I know that we do have a wide range of listeners to this podcast, including, I'm sure, many people who are on boards themselves. So I'd actually be really curious as to know what our listeners who are on boards, how they would define it.
Yeah.
Like many board members and directors, I've attended a five-day company directors course where they spend 5 days answering that question. But for the sake of the brevity on this podcast, if I was to give a one-line answer, I'd probably say boards are a layer, an additional layer of governance separate to the staff that really are there to give a more bird's eye picture and perspective to help guide the organization. In one sense, boards represent the owners. So in a corporate board where you've got shareholders, the board members are really directly meant to be representing the ownership interests of the company. And for a non-corporate board, like a charity, like the one I'm on, boards are there to represent the mission and values and the members of that organization. So it is a big responsibility, and you get the paperwork before you sign up to make sure that you know what you're actually signing up to. And it is a opportunity to be taken seriously, because you are there really to be the custodians of the organization, which sometimes sounds quite scary, but it's about acting in the best interests of that organization and taking that responsibility with great care and the seriousness which it deserves.
Mm, absolutely. And further to what you were sharing then, a few people that I've been speaking to about being on a board, they also tell me that no two boards are ever the same. And I guess, yeah, there's courses and there's training and those, like you said, that five-day course that you did, which had been so beneficial. But I also took comfort in the fact, you know, that there's not a set way of how to do things. And I guess each boards are comprised of different people, different skill sets that would also play into how they look and how they're made up.
Absolutely. In fact, I can add to that. I think another key definition or a key thing about boards is a clear distinction between the management and then the boards who are governance. And I think where boards go wrong is when they get too hands-on in managing the day-to-day activities of the company, because that's not what a board is there for. That's what the staff are for. Yep. That's why you employ and hire great people to run the company. So boards need to be wary of not going too much into the details, but operating at that strategic level. So again, it's about helping set and then guide the strategic direction of the organization. And really, to me, that's why it seems a great fit for a discussion on the Future Report podcast, because boards to me should be all about the future and looking to the future and helping guide an organization through to that future.
Mm. And like you shared earlier, I guess that makes a lot of sense. Hopefully it makes a lot of sense to you and me who work at McCrindle, but hopefully even to our listeners in terms of why the services that we offer, like research and those strategy pieces, that makes sense as to why we are working and why you're working often with boards of organizations who are coming to us asking those questions. Do you have anything else to add, Grant, in terms of the role of a board in the future of an organization or in future-proofing an organization?
Yeah, well, like I said, there's 5-day courses on the role of the board. So I think maybe I'll share a couple of quick thoughts, and if you want to add to that, you can. I think the board's really key to a well-functioning board is the relationship with the CEO, and I think by extension, the executive team. Because as you said, each board, each company, organization operates a little differently. But I've heard it said that the one job and only job of a board is to find the right CEO. That's it.
Wow.
And I think that's kind of a pithy way of saying it, which I think meant to get you thinking and questioning, going, oh, really, is that all? But I think the purpose, the idea behind that sentiment is that the CEO is the one who's they're running the ship, so to speak. But the board is the key, really key to make sure you've got the right person there who is able to really set and champion the vision of the company with the staff and bring the stakeholders, the community on that journey. So the relationship between a board and a CEO is really critical, that's good. And particularly the board, the role of the chair of the board and the CEO is a very important one. So I think that's something that comes to mind about the role of a board. But also, I think another one is boards are really essential in setting and modeling culture to an organization.
Mm.
And I feel like this is a discussion that has been brought to the surface a bit more recently in the last few years. I think we've seen some very high profile examples of toxic organizational cultures. And often in those cases, it's the board who are front and center, either because a board member's getting high profile sacking, or that there's some news that's come out which is unethical or even criminal behavior sometimes. So I think now it's generally accepted that the culture needs to be set from the top and modeled all the way through an organization. So I think in that sense, boards really have an important role in setting the culture as well. And again, working with the executive team to model the kind of culture that they want. Because when we think about the future, culture flows through to the kind of people you're going to attract and retain. So if you have a good culture, then I think that's going to put you in good stead to attracting and keeping the right kind of people to move your organization forward.
Yeah, and we've talked about this before on the podcast a little bit, and I know that you know at McCrindle we talk a lot about and we believe a lot in the power of culture. And yeah, it's really helpful even to think about that flowing through an organization, even from a board level. They're not, like you said in that, and like I said in the intro, they're not necessarily this removed part of the organization, but it does flow on from there. So that's really interesting. And I think, you know, there's been a lot of discussion in recent times about improving the diversity across boards, the diversity of people involved in boards, particularly about gender, about age and cultural diversity. How are you seeing that discussion play out, and do you feel like that's changing?
Well, I think going back to your intro, I think with some of the common perceptions of boards, certainly it's one I hear a lot, is, oh, it's always pale, male and stale, or, you know, words to that effect, which as a male, that, yeah, I feel a bit of that, even though I don't match some of those other criteria in that statement. But I think that For some people, maybe that's what they picture when they picture a board, because I think historically that's probably been largely true. But the things are changing, as you alluded to. And I think, as we know from the work we do, the world is changing so rapidly. Emergence of new trends, generational change, and just the impact on how that changes the game for organizations in engaging different generations. We know that the world is more global than ever as well. So we probably have listeners here from across the world, but particularly in Australia, we're such a multicultural society. So I think really simply boards should ensure that there is input there and there is an understanding and appreciation of the different kinds of stakeholder groups that you're trying to reach. And so I think that's why it makes great sense for boards to be as diverse as the people they're trying to engage and reach, because that's where you get the value of different perspectives, different backgrounds, different skill sets. So that's another thing I think that is important for boards, that they, particularly in a not-for-profit board where the directors, it's not a paid role, they're not working day-to-day in that organization. They have a day job and then they have the board role on top. So they're usually bringing a completely different set of skills and background experience. And I think that it's important for boards to leverage the power of that kind of diversity to bring that to your future planning and kind of the big picture management.
Yeah, it's really important. And I think, you know, I love what you shared there just around the, whether it's, you know, the staff of an organization or the senior executive leadership team or the board and governance level, you know, I remember Mark and I were talking about this and writing about it in the Work Wellbeing book around diversity, and not for it to be a tokenistic ticker box kind of element, but actually, like you said, it enables an organization to better connect and understand the stakeholders that they're serving, whether that's clients or customers, if you get that range of perspective. And yeah, I think also that diversity, like you mentioned, is a way of future-proofing, because especially when you're thinking about younger generations, you know, sharing the perspective of what's going on in their cohort, that can be a really great way when you've got a diverse range of experience, perspective, age, gender, cultural background that enables you to future-proof yourself in some way. So hopefully that's an encouragement for people.
Yeah, absolutely. And I think I've benefited from having other board members, and particularly the chairs, so current and previous chair of the board that I'm part of, who were very visionary and forward thinking. And I think I'm really the reason I got that opportunity at the age of 26 was the chair at the time really saw the need to ensure there was a range of voices inputting even at that board level. So yeah, it's really, I love that the organization, the board that I'm part of, it does reflect a great mix of gender, different ages, stages of life, experiences. Mm. And I think that's important just to future-proof. I think it's not about ticking quota boxes. I think if you understand that people bring really valuable perspectives and can bring skills and different subject matter expertise, then it's a no-brainer that you want to have a diverse mix of people. And no doubt in boards, you do need some technical skills. So most boards would have someone with specific kind of legal training, because that's a lot of what boards deal with is compliance and legal and all that kind of fun stuff. So yeah, I studied law at uni, but never went on to practice law. So I suppose I unfortunately have an appreciation for some of that stuff, and not everyone does, but that's really important, I think, around a boardroom, but also that auditing and accounting background, because a lot of what you look at as a board as well is financials and being able to read and make sense of that, just as you and I make sense of data and numbers and pick out the stories from that. You have to do that at a boardroom level too with financial data. So I think there's some skills there that are very specific, which pretty much all boards need. And then in addition to that, ensuring that you've got those people who can represent and understand and empathize with different groups of people that you're trying to reach. To me, that's a no-brainer to be future-proofing your organization that way.
Yeah, absolutely. And I'm sure it's a very rewarding role as well, in terms of when, especially if, like for you, Grant, who's been on the board for a number of years now of the organization that you're involved with, to see the changes that maybe at a board have started at a board level or have either maybe been presented to the board and, yeah, seen people impacted around that. And I imagine it's a very rewarding role as well that board members play.
Definitely. I think if you didn't find that rewarding, then you probably wouldn't put in the time and the effort, particularly when it's a voluntary role. So yeah, for me, I feel absolutely grateful. And you're right. I think it's 6 years now that I've been on the board. So we have seen a lot of change in that time, a lot of renewal, and that does excite me. There's no doubt. Yeah, there's lots of challenges with the world changing, and particularly around how we leverage technology and changing stakeholder base. But I'm excited about, yeah, to see some of those decisions that were made 2 years ago, 3 years ago, 5 years ago. You can see the long-term impacts, which is very exciting.
And it's amazing, Grant, even at your, 32 years of life experience, you've got quite a lot of years of experience under your belt as a board member if you joined at 26. And I guess as someone who, with that context, as someone, at McCrindle who is advising boards, who's speaking to board members of different organisations and sectors, as someone who believes in, the validity of younger generations and the value that they bring to the conversation, what advice do you have for maybe an organization, or if we've got, someone who is on a board of an organization listening and they're convinced from our chat today, or maybe hopefully not just our chat, but other resources, that they might want to add some younger voices to their board? What advice do you have for organizations who maybe have been inspired by that idea?
Ooh, well, I'm sure there's others much wiser than me who could give some great advice there, but I think what I would say to encourage people is I'm the product of, and I benefited from visionary leaders who sought to include a range of voices. So our previous chair, Richard Grellman or Grelly, I'm very grateful to Grelly, and our current chair, Anne Robinson, is also someone who champions the next generation. And so I'm living proof of being on the receiving end of that. So I think I think having younger voices is really important, particularly if you're trying to reach a multi-generational stakeholder base. But it also, I think it's more important to have a posture of listening, because it's about having that posture to listen and to try to understand what is changing. And generally a younger person, a younger board member like me, I don't have the 30 years career experience that someone in their 50s or 60s would bring to a board. But what I can bring is a lot of the challenges that are impacting organizations around, say, technology, changing social attitudes, those things are second nature to me. So I don't maybe have some of the experience and technical skills, but I have the worldview, if you like, and the outlook that can really be helpful, because, even some of the things you discuss at Boardroom, like CRM platform and digital and all these kind of, some of which are really big decisions for an organization, some of those, tech things and ways of thinking and doing tend to be quite second nature for a younger audience. And so that's some of the ways that they can bring real value. So I think you want to expect different things from different people. And I think I'm very grateful that people looked at me and said, well, yeah, he's not going to come in and add 40 years of career experience, but you do want to feel like you're bringing something. And I think sometimes it's just being able to identify that for yourself, what it is that you can bring and contribute. So yeah, I encourage boards. I think it is important to have that range of voices. But also to have, you might have people on the board who, not everyone has to be young, but you can have people who are more senior in years, but actually have a greater appreciation of the younger generations and the value they can bring. So it might even be bringing in like an advisor role, or bring in for a one-off presentation. There's kind of some innovative ways that boards can actually engage those younger perspectives, in addition to having people on the board with those perspectives.
Mm. And I love what you shared then just around the role of listening. And I'm sure that that's something because, yeah, if you're being invited to be on a board, like you said, you're bringing something that is of value to that conversation, to that table, so to speak. But we, I think as humans, we never want to, keeps us humble to know that we always want to be a posture of listening. And yeah. I'm reminded of that quote from, I think it was Stephen Covey, who said, seek first to understand, then to be understood. And I guess that also plays in, and that's, I mean, it's a key philosophy for us because we're researchers. So we're constantly asking questions of cohorts, whether it's through surveys or focus groups or in-depth interviews or even data sets and Excel spreadsheets.
Well, sometimes when people ask me, what does a social researcher do? Sometimes I say, look, we're just professional listeners, really.
Yeah.
We listen and we observe and we study.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. And I guess that leads me into my next question, just around the tools of our trade, in terms of what role do you think research and advisory, the areas that we really play in and that you help organizations to, I guess, engage with, what role do those tools play in helping boards make informed decisions?
Well, I think one of the challenges of the modern board and modern society is there's so much change, right? There's so many variables. We talk about the MAE, we're in a multifactorial society, it's accelerating and expanding. So there's a lot of change and sometimes it feels quite overwhelming. So the role of the board is to try to sift through all of that to sift out what is the noise and what is actually really important for us to focus on. So in that sense, I think that's why the work we do at McCrindle really helps, is very helpful for boards, because that's exactly what we do. We're all about trying to sift through all of the things that are changing, all of the trends, and just to sort through what is fad and what is actually trend and what are things that are going to be really significant, and then distilling that information down. And I think that's probably another key thing about boards is there's a lot of information, but you don't actually have long to talk about it because no one wants to spend a whole week talking about things. You want to be focused on doing, and certainly the CEO and the executive team don't want to be stuck in endless meetings just kind of talking about things in a circular way. So I think a key thing that boards look for is communicating information simply and clearly without being simplistic. And I don't profess to be an expert on that. I think it's a tough task. So I think you want people who specialize in that. And I think one of the pieces of feedback that we get at McCrindle is that that's something that we put a lot of work into doing. How do you take complex things, complexity of the world, communicate it simply? So yeah, I think that's probably one way that our tools play in. I think another thing is boards are looking, again, that big picture view, the bird's eye view. So what are the mega trends? What are the big rocks I should be aware of? Some people might use that language. And I think, again, that's where our expertise comes in. We can actually present that to boards, and we do that quite often, either as a presentation or in like a strategy workshop. So understanding the broader trends. But then also boards want to keep a finger on the pulse of their own people, their own stakeholders. And often that's reported through the executive team. So it might be understanding their customers, understanding their staff, understanding their members, depending on the nature of the organization, or donors. If it's a charity like ours is, understanding donor sentiment is really important. Mm. So that's the kind of research that we do at McCrindle to understand those different stakeholder groups. And that might be through surveys or qualitative research, but it's all about understanding the external environment and then the internal environment, and then you've got those insights at your disposal to actually make those really important decisions. I think the worst thing to do would be to fly blind and to try to make some pretty weighty and impactful decisions without that kind of data at your disposal.
Mm. Yeah, it's so much about, like, that's exactly our philosophy in terms of And I think we've talked about it with Mark, even on the podcast before, around the power of research to confirm or deny hypothesis and to, yeah, challenge maybe perceptions. Like you said, when you're tasked, whether you are a board member or you're a leader in an organization, if you're making strategic decisions, to not just make those on gut instinct or gut feel, but to actually have data and evidence and stories to back those up. And yeah, if you're trying to make a case to convince a certain group of people in your organization or a board, that data can really be, and research can really be very powerful in yeah, making decisions that impact people, stakeholders, create change. So yeah, it's something that we love to do and love to help organizations with. And it's great when you get to, and I know that you've done this too, Grant, when you're involved from taking the initial inquiry and hearing someone's pain points that research can help solve to then, you know, months later, having conducted all the research and presented it maybe to a board level, they say, this is what we're going to go and do now as a result of that research. So, I mean, yeah, everyone knows that we know and we believe that research is powerful. I don't need to tell you that at all.
Yeah, but I do agree totally, 100%.
Good. Well, thank you so much for the chat today, Grant. I think it's been just really interesting, I guess, almost like busting a few maybe myths or perceptions that people may have held maybe prior to this conversation from your own experience as a board member yourself, as a you know, young millennial serving on a board, to as well your role in advising organizations and boards. And yeah, I really loved those elements that you shared. And hopefully it's a helpful conversation for our younger listeners who may be like your 26-year-old self, maybe aspiring one day to be on a board maybe sooner than they think, to as well encouraging current or prospective older generations and older board members to consider that variety and that diversity in perspective and age and life stage that, yeah, engaging different people with different skills can bring to that conversation, those conversations that are being having, that are being had at that strategic level, yeah, to benefit those people who are involved in an organization at different levels, from stakeholders and consumers and clients. So incredible insights. Thank you for making your debut on the podcast on this topic, Grant. Can't wait to have you back again soon.
Thanks, Ash. It was fun.
I'm glad. And to our listeners, thank you for listening. As always, we'd love to hear what you think of the podcast. So you can leave us a review in that way. You can connect with us on social media, contact us on our website. And of course, to stay up to date with our latest insights at McCrindle, you can subscribe to the podcast and follow us on social media. So once again, thank you for listening and bye for now.